فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Firstly, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them, to bless all those who have struggled through the generations in order to bring the deen to us the way we have it today. We ask Allah to bless them, to bless every one of us, to make us from those who can preserve the deen, and to pass the baton on to the next generations and to those who are around us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us rightly guided. My brothers and sisters, perhaps who may hear this later, I wish to share with you some very interesting hadith. It is connected to the most powerful speech that is in existence. That is the Quran. The Quran is the most powerful word in existence. The reason is, it's the word of Allah. It is not your speech or mine. It is not even the speech of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is the speech of Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This Quran is so powerful that even if you don't understand it, and if you repeat its words, it has in it such power, because it is the word of Allah, that it is cure for your diseases and sicknesses. The sicknesses of the heart, the spiritual sicknesses, the social ills, those ills that might be physical as well, your sicknesses of every nature, because it is the word spoken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us about the Quran. He has told us a lot about the Quran. But one narration is very interesting and it's very powerful. It is known as Jawami'ul Kalim. That means short words with a very, very vast meaning. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a sentence, that sentence had in it meaning that could fill a whole book. That is known as Jawami'ul Kalim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the power of eloquence. He could speak in a way that even those who were linguists were mesmerized. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, Al-Qur'anu hujjatul laka aw alayka. Done. Beautiful hadith. This Quran will either be for you as a witness or against you as a witness. Full stop. So what is the meaning of it? I told you we can fill a whole book of the meaning. In a nutshell, your obligation and mine unto the word of Allah, starting with understanding what exactly it is and what my duty towards it is, and going on to fulfilling it, to practicing it, to being able to put it within your life, to be able to let it lead you to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and passing the baton on to others. All of this is part of my duty towards the Quran. And that will either come on the day of judgment for me or against me. The Quran will bear witness for you or against you. If you didn't read the Quran, it bears witness against you. You are a stranger. Who are you? You never ever read me. And if you read it, it will come and say, oh Allah, this man read me. Some can read the Quran beautifully. Some can read fast. Some can read slow. Some are stuck when they read. Allah says, if you are a professional in reading the Quran and you are so good at reciting the Quran, what will happen? You will have a good reward. You will be with those who are high because you made an effort to learn it and to be able to read it in the most melodious way. But if you struggle while you are reading the Quran, if you suffer while you are reading the Quran, if you are taking too long and it's time consuming, but you still make an effort to read it, the hadith says you have a double reward. Double reward. Why? Because you are putting in a bigger effort than the guy who's cruising along. A man moving in a small vehicle or a rickshaw. that is actually going from point A to point B deserves the medal when he has gone 500 kilometers rather than the guy sitting in the Mercedes and cruising. He will get there. He has gotten there. But the one who really make an effort deserves the medal is the one who was on the bicycle. Same applies with us. You made a bigger effort, bigger energy. You deserve a medal. You did something that was impossible or difficult. So this is why do not despair. Keep your relation with the Quran such that you make an effort to open it every day, at least one verse. If you haven't done that, you are insulting yourself. You are insulting your relationship with Allah. To start the day with Quran in salah is such a beautiful, beautiful feeling. Allah guarantees you that if you start your day in my obedience, I will make sure it ends in a beautiful way. Subhanallah. So my beloved brothers, my sisters, this is the primary duty towards the Quran. We must make sure we read it, recite it. We must make sure we understand the power of it. Allah says the Quran has shifa. Shifa, I told you, cure. The cure is in the verses, in the practicing of it, in the understanding. أَذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ. Those who believe, they find comfort in the remembrance of Allah, primarily starting with the Quran. For indeed, it is only and solely in the remembrance of Allah that the heart is calmed. You want the calmness of your heart, you want contentment, you want peace in your life. If you don't have the Quran and the dhikr, which is the remembrance of Allah, which starts with the Quran, you are not going to get the calmness no matter where you search. No matter where you look, it's not coming. It's not going to come. Why? Because you are looking in the wrong place. You went to the petrol station to buy milk. That's what happened. You're not going to get milk. You will burn yourself. You'll get something that's going to poison you. So we need the calmness. We have been told where the calmness is, but we are not interested in looking for it where it is. We look for it in everything else. People look for it in the latest, the gadgets, the technology, the materialism. That is a byproduct. But the asal and the origin is actually the word of Allah. It will calm you. He made you. He knows you need it. This is why those who have replaced the Quran with music have actually done a disservice to their hearts and minds and souls, because the Quran is so beautiful that everyone has a different style of recitation. Every recital is different. You hear the reciters of the world. You can draw a list. Each one has a different recital. The reason is you will have a different recital that soothes you, and the man right next to you will have a different recital that soothes him. But there are two different types of reading. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The melodies are actually countless. Subhanallah. Listen to all the different reciters. You will immediately pick up, this is this sheikh, this is that hafid, this is this qari, you know. And there is one or two that your favorite. Sometimes it changes. They were your favorite, then you heard someone else who became your favorite, because your emotions are in need of a melody in order to calm it. That is now a different melody than it was 2 years back. That's the calmness of the heart. Allah gave it to you. But my brothers, my sisters, that is not your only duty to the Quran. You have another duty. There is another duty. The first duty is to recite it, whether you understand it or not. To be able to listen to it, to be able to respect it, to be able to adopt it, to be able to actually let it give you the calmness. It will happen when the Arabic is read, because the Arabic is the word of Allah. He spoke it, He said it, it was recorded. Jibreel alayhi salam came down with it. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍ مُبِينٍ. The most trusted was sent down with this book straight into your heart, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in clear cut Arabic, so that you can warn with this Quran the people. Warn them about what? What's to come. It is so beautiful. You know, when you read the prophecies of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wallahi, you will find that everything is coming true one by one. You can tick it. You can actually tick it. An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the Quran It came down. Yes, the Arabic is the word of Allah. You will get 10 rewards for every letter you read. 10 rewards minimum for every letter. When you say, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. You must lose count of how much reward you are getting for having read that, because that is the mercy of Allah. It's impossible for someone to count while he is reading. Impossible, because Allah wants to show you, I will give you more than you can dream of, more than you can calculate yourself. When you say Alif Lam Mim, it's not one word, it is three different letters. You get 30 rewards minimum. But my brothers and sisters, I was talking about the other duty on regarding the Quran. You have to make an effort to try to understand the word of Allah. That is also a duty. You will have the tafsir lesson in the masjid once a week, maybe twice a week, maybe more, maybe less. Make an effort to attend. It is the word of Allah. It is a very, very important word. You want to know why you were created? Allah says, we sent you a messenger with a message. What is that message? It is the Quran. And that Quran, if you understand it correctly, it is going to lead you to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Whatever the messenger has given you, instructed you, take it as an instruction. Whatever he has prohibited and stopped, consider it prohibited and fear Allah. That means you have to follow the Rasul, his sunnah, the hadith, whatever his lifestyle is, that is part and parcel of what the Quran has asked you to follow. So today, there are some people who say, we only believe in the Quran. As for the hadith, we discount it. As for the sunnah, we discount it. That is a dangerous statement, because if you truly follow the Quran, it will automatically lead you to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Automatically. So if you are not following the hadith and the sunnah and the path of the Prophet ﷺ, it means you haven't even understood the Quran. You haven't even understood the Quran. So in essence, you need to make an effort to learn the Quran, the meaning of the Quran. It is also very, very important. If someone were to ask you that what is more important, to read the Arabic or to read the English or the language I understand, the answer is they are both important. But of primary value, the recitation in Arabic is greater in spirituality and reward. Why? I was speaking to a group of friends and I said, it is similar to eating. If I ask you what is more important, the food or the water, the food or the liquid, the core food or the liquid, you have to say both are important, but the food is the asal, it is the origin, it is what you need. The water will only push it down, it will help you to digest it, it is the water. So the relationship between this and that is quite similar, where the original food is actually the Quran itself in the Arabic, because it is the word of Allah. There is no substitute for it. The meaning is the attempt of mankind to explain to you what they have understood from the word of Allah. That's the meaning. They could be right, there could also be differences of opinion regarding translation and regarding different types of understandings. But the word of Allah, there's no difference, because there is one word of Allah, Al-Quran. So this is why these are two duties that we have. When we fulfill this duty, when we take our time to recite the Quran, I have a problem, personally. You can call it a problem and you can even call it a positive point. It's okay. I find it impossible to read the Quran very fast, because it's an insult. I can't. I cannot do it. I had a problem years ago with people who said, this man reads too slow. But I'd rather arrive on the day of Qiyamah, and may Allah accept it from all of us, and be able to recite in a way that people can understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with the way you read His word, than to zoom through it just because I want to please the public. Because there is another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, the person who has memorized the Quran on the day of judgment, even if you've memorized a portion, inshallah, you will be included in this. Allah will call you and tell you, اقرأ وارتقي ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فإن منزلك عند آخر آية تقرأها. Read and ascend, and keep on going up as long as you are reading. For indeed your status and your level and your final abode will be where you stop, where you are getting stuck. So, the hadith uses a term that is very serious. It says, read the way you used to read in the dunya. That's all. We forget that part. So some people, they read so fast with so much lack of trying to please Allah with the recitation that when they arrive on the day of Qiyamah, what are they going to do? They will read in an embarrassing way because that was the only way they read in the dunya. So therefore Allah says, وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. The instruction that Allah gave His most beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and by extension it is to all of us. Allah says, recite the Quran melodiously. Recite it melodiously. If you are to zoom through the word of Allah, it will insult you. Like I said, the Quran either bears witness for you or against you. رُبَّ قَارِئٍ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنُ يَلْعَنُهُ. Sometimes there are people who read the Quran while it is cursing them because they are insulting it. Allah doesn't need you or me. We need Allah. I must back up my ideas, my system, my way, and I must come closer to Allah through this Quran. So the biggest gift that we have is the fact that we are the ummah of the Quran. Do not underestimate it. I call on you, my brothers, my sisters, to replace the CDs you have of music with the Quran. Replace it. It's not needed. Put the Quran, the word of Allah. It will have shifa in it. When you are listening to Quran on a disc or on the radio or anywhere else, don't just listen. Try and read with the recitation. You will get a double, triple, quadruple reward. Many of us listen to beautiful recital. Move your mouth with it. Say something with it. You know, some of our children, may Allah protect us, in some instances, they memorize the songs of those who are singing songs across the globe. They memorize them, but they haven't memorized the words of one surah of the Quran. It's a fact. So don't you think we can change that? Inshallah we can. By the will of Allah. We need to strengthen ourselves. My brothers and sisters, we are the ummah of the Quran. We will meet on the day of Qiyamah with the Nabi of the Quran. We will meet with the Nabi of the Quran, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We expect his intercession on the day of Qiyamah. The only time we will get it is if we tried. If we tried to follow him. If we tried to give respect to what Allah has given it to. So we would like the Quran to bear witness for us and not against us. We would like to bear witness. We would like it to bear witness for us and not against us. And the last point I remembered just now, if you allow me, I know I've taken more than the time I thought I would take, but it's okay. In our houses and our homes, sometimes we have verses of the Quran that are hung up as decoration. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. You enter the house, you see the verse of the Quran in big decoration. You exiting the house, you see this Ayatul Kursi, big decoration. You entered on the right side, you see the three quls on big decoration. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. May Allah protect us. You must be surprised. Why? What's so big? What's wrong with it? Did Allah reveal the Quran as a decoration? Did Allah reveal the Quran as an adornment? Did Allah send down the Quran to be able to say it looks nice? Did Allah send a very lovely Quran for you to be able to put it on your wall in order to fill the gap that is on the wall, and you walk past and people say, very lovely, where did you get it? Where did I get what? Why are you insulting the Quran? Allah says, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. A book that is blessed that we have revealed to you in order that you ponder deeply over its verses. That's why we revealed it to you. We revealed it to you so that its verses can be pondered deeply over, so your life can change. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu heard a few verses, his life changed. We listen to one khatam, two khatams, three khatams. Nothing changed because for us it's a decoration. It's a beautiful sound. A'udhu billah. Where is the brain gone? So now what should we do? Because I have it in my house. What can I do? Very simple remedy. When you enter the house and you see the beautiful Ayatul Kursi, stop for one moment and read it. When you see the three quls on the right wall, stop for a moment and read it. Understand it. So you know, I read this. I read this every other day. When we pass, we read. It's a reminder. So if it's up there as a reminder to you to read, no problem. But if it's up there solely as decoration, wallahi, we have a problem. Take it out, replace it with something else. If you're not going to read, and no one is going to read, and it's just there solely as decoration, think about what I'm telling you. Think about it. It will bear witness against you. That same plaque will come and say, I was hung on the wall, no one ever bothered reading me. No one did. At the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, they didn't have books like we have today. They had plaques, they had little parchments they used to write on, small pieces of wood and skin. And you know what? They used to read all of that. We don't value this. So what I'm saying is, you have hung it, fair enough, but read it. Once in a while, read it. Once a week, you read it. Someone read it. Encourage people, say, you see that cool? They say, it's very beautiful. Say, yes, try and read it a little bit. You did your duty. Do you know, they hang the 99 names of Allah. Okay, that is not part of the Quran. But why did you hang it? Have you ever read two of the names, three of them? If every time you enter your house, you read two names, three names, wallahi, by the time the month ends, you are already so close so much to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make it easy for us. As you can see, I can go on and on and on and on. But inshallah, we will call it a day by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm really, really happy to be here in this beautiful city of Bangalore in India. Very impromptu, very private visit. But the masjid is the masjid, it's the house of Allah. We have to come. And I was asked to say a few words to share with the brothers and sisters perhaps who may hear this. So we have done so. May Allah accept it from me, from all of us. And may these words be life-changing. May these words be life-changing. Because if we take the nasiha seriously, it will change our lives. Not because I said it. It's nothing to do with me. It is to do with the power of a message that Allah has sent us. I would not be seated on this chair if I didn't tell you, قَالَ اللَّهُ وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ. If I didn't have a message from Allah and His Rasul, I would not be seated here. But because the message is related to Allah and His Rasul, so you have sat down and heard me. Some of you might have important things to do right now. May Allah give you barakah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all ease. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Barakallahu.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Kita syukuri atas kasih karunia Allah yang kita berikan kepada kita.